We will of course start with a quick review of what we did in lecture 2 so that there is a connectivity from where you left off last time. And then today we will continue with the example on relative stability of DCB specimen in load control and displacement control. If you remember, we gave it to you as an example that please solve it yourself and we'll discuss the solution later. Then today we will start a totally new section on stress analysis of cracks. Under that, stress intensity factor, relationship between K and global behavior, effect of finite size, and principle of superposition. After that, we start a new section on relationship between K and G, and we'll see how much of this we can actually cover today. So in the previous lecture, we covered the three methods in which the surface energy can be used to define WF, the work required to create a fracture. We did an example on a flat. Then we started the whole big topic of energy release rate. We defined capital G, the energy. We used the concept of compliance from solid mechanics and so on. We took the example of a double cantilevered beam and finding out the energy release rate, capital G, for this situation. We solved the whole example, found a final solution and expression. We then started the new section on instability and the R curve. We told you that R is the resistance curve or the driving force curve. G is the driving force and R is the resistance of the material resistance to crack extent. We showed you the flat R curve and the rising R curve. We discussed how in actual materials the R curve can be flat and rising and decreasing. We told you the conditions for stable crack growth and the condition for unstable crack growth, and they are basically in terms of the rate of change of G with respect to A, the cracks. Reasons for the R curve shape, there is an ideally brittle material, there are metals which have ductility. The topic of load control versus displacement control, we reminded you that in doing all tensile experiments and other experiments in the machine, we can either control the load or we can control the displacement, assigning at which speed the loading will be done and so forth. And towards the end of the lecture, we left you with this example that there is a DCB specimen, the double cantilever beam specimen, and you find the relative stability in load control and in displacement control, right? And we asked you that please solve it, don't give up, and make sure that you think that your solution is totally correct. And then today we will discuss its details. So that was the previous lecture, and now we start with the new lecture. So as we promised, we have the same example. So as you have done earlier, you see it was initially a notched V. It was initially a notched V, and this was being pulled under mode 1 loading, right? Under mode 1 loading. So it created a total displacement of delta under a total load of P. If we divide this now centrally into two pieces, then each one piece, for example, the bottom piece is a normal cantilever beam. It is supported there and it is being bent here. The displacement here is delta by 2. And this length is A until here. And this height is H, right? So this is what you already have, right? This is what you already have. So let us now see, you have already done it, hopefully. So just to remind you, because the question was about stability, for a stable crack growth, G is equal to R, and this rate dGdA should be less than or equal to dRdA. And if this rate becomes equal to or more than DRDA, then we have unstable crack growth. So therefore, G is equal to R is of course one thing, but the main thing that you have to do is find the rate DGDA, right? DGDA. So let us do that. From the previous example that you finished, G is equal to P squared A squared BEI, right? This is there. And we have to find DGDA. If we have to find DGDA, this is small p means under load control, load P, and later on we can see under displacement control, right? So load control. So just do that, differentiate it with respect to A. You see, all other things are then constant. P squared, B, E, I are all constants, and you differentiate A squared, you get 2A, right? So it is as simple as this. It is as simple as this, that you do this. When we say in load control, then it simply means that in the expression here, P should be there. When we say displacement control, in the expression here, delta should be there. So this is no issue. This was the equation. We did the differential DGDA, and only A squared was the function for A. So that became 2A, and you have this equation. This is a simpler version. You see, when you see it is equal to this, then you compare this equation and you can see that this thing is 2 upon AG, right? If you compare with this, then this is 2 upon AG. So this is the DGDA under load control. You have this expression or this expression, right? Now, remember from the beam theory and previous example, we had done this again. This is from previous. Delta by 2 is PA cubed upon 3EI. We have done this from standard beam theory. So just rearrange this so that load can be separated. We have a load equation, right? So load can be separated. So from here, P is equal to so much. Okay. And once again, you go back to the original equation of G. And then in this equation, remember this one line step is one end of the solution. We have to find the stability, right? We have to find the stability, which is DGDA under load control. So this is done. This is just in one step, it is finished. Now it is the second step that we are doing. We want to change the P to delta so that now you can use the same equation and use the DGDA, but under delta. So that is what we are doing. We start with this, we change P is equal to so much, you go back to the original equation of G. In that equation, instead of P, you write this 3 delta EI, right? So it is P square, so 9 delta square and so on, okay? You substitute this, G now becomes this, okay? Remember, from here, P is equal to so much in terms of delta, from the original equation on G, you put P is equal to so much in this equation, simplify it. Now you have an equation for G in terms of delta. So again, do DGDA. Again, do DGDA. DGDA, that is it. But this time it is in terms of delta. So we say DGDA sub delta. Here in the whole thing, 1 upon A4 or A raised to minus 4. All other things are the same. 9 delta squared E I upon 4B all remain the same. A raised to minus 4 becomes minus 4 upon A5, right? Minus 4 upon A5. So that is what you do. You do this, and then you will see that the 4 and the 4 cancel out. The minus sign is here, and A4 has become A5. So this is now the expression DGDA, stability expression under load control. Again, compare it to this G, and you will see that this is equal to minus 4 upon AG, minus 4 upon AG, right? This in terms of delta, right? So compare this with this G, which is delta. This was P, so that was there, but here this is the G in terms of delta. Compare our solution of DGDA with this, and this is equal to minus 4G by A. So now final results. DGDA under load control is 2 upon AG. dg dA under displacement control is minus 4 upon A g. So, right, g is there. This is plus 2 by A, this is minus 4 by A. So, this of course is smaller in number, isn't it? This is minus, whatever it is smaller than this number. And if you remember, for stability, lower energy is always more stable, right? So, now you can have this. The driving force increases with crack growth in load control and decreases in displacement control, right? This is the rate of change. This rate of change is positive. So, if this rate of change in the driving force is positive, the driving force is increasing, right? This rate of change in driving force is negative, so the driving force is decreasing. So, in load control, the driving force is increasing because the rate of change is positive, and here it is decreasing. So, the driving force increases with crack growth in load control and decreases in displacement control, right? So, therefore, for a flat R curve, crack growth in load control is always unstable because the driving force keeps on increasing while displacement control is always stable. So, you see, this is very interesting. I don't know how you feel about it. I told you last time also that now this is an elective level course, which is like equal to a beginning course in a master's degree. Right, so the concepts are important, but you see that the math is not very complicated. Math is not very complicated. Very simple result here, very simple result here. But the thing is that once you have this result, and once you have this result, then can you think of these results yourselves, these comments, these final things? So this means you understand the physics of the problem, you understand the mechanics of the problem, right? It is not just the equation. The equation is the mathematical part of it. Your being very good in that is critically important, yes. But even if you are very good in the mathematical part, and if you solve the problem, in the end, do you make physical sense? Does it make mechanistic sense? That mechanics of the problem is there. It is fracture mechanics, right? So this last sentence is very, very important. Now, that example was from last time, we have finished it. So, as I said, we start a totally new topic now, stress analysis of cracks. So, we are just showing you a diagram that this is the crack tip, this is the crack tip. And we are taking only a plain stress formulation. Plain means that the third one, you see Y is there, but z is there, z is not there, x and y are there. So at the crack tip there is some stress, and this is the way you did it in solid mechanics and so on, that you define it like this, that there is a small element, and here is sigma yy, here is sigma xx. So of course this is the opposite of that, this is the opposite of that, and then there is the shear stress, tau xy and tau yx. So this completely defines the state of stress at the crack tip. And at any distance, we can use polar coordinates r and theta. If this is the location, then the distance is r and the angle is theta. Or you can use the rectangular Cartesian coordinates of x and y. So you can use any coordinate system you like to locate the point. And we have found earlier in science that the polar one r theta is easier to do, because then at a certain distance from the crack, whether the point is here or the point is there, if the distance from the crack is the same, the stresses will be the same. So rather than defining x for this one and x for this one and x for this one, if r is the same, then the state of stress at the same distance will be the same. So defining it in terms of r and theta will be easier, right? We sometimes feel a little diffident, unconfident, but that is not an issue. A rectangular xy can very quickly be converted into a polar r theta and so on.